the coming up two lectures, we are going to look at the equivalence between context-free grammars and push-down automata. That is, if for a language L, we can write a context-free grammar, we can also create a push-down automata for L and vice versa. This is similar to how for our regular languages, we proved that. So, for our regular languages, we were having our finite state machines and we proved the equivalence of finite state machines with the regular expressions. We have shown that for a language L, if we have a finite state automata, we can create a corresponding regular expression, and if there is a regular expression, we can create the corresponding finite automata. Similarly, we are going to do the same thing with these two constructs. So, for doing this, let us first understand what we have to prove. So, given a context-free grammar G, assume that the language of this grammar G is L1. What does that mean? That means that this G, it is able to generate every string which is there in L1. And if a string is not in L1, it cannot be generated by this grammar G. Right. In the case of a pushdown automata P, we say that the language of P is L1 in case for every string which is in L1, P reaches to the final state, otherwise not. This proof comprises of two parts. The first one is, given a context-free grammar G which recognizes a language L, produce an equivalent PDA which also recognizes L. And the second part is, given a PDA P which recognizes the language L, produce an equivalent grammar. So, we will be taking this first part in the current lecture. The second part we will do in the next one. Proving the first part is an easy one. So, given a context-free grammar, we have to produce an equivalent PDA. Before proceeding with the proof, let us look at an example to get the intuition of what we are going to do. Assume that we are given a grammar G. How do we know whether a string is generated by this grammar or not? Let's say I have a grammar of this form. We have this grammar here, where say B is S, terminals are A and B, production rules we'll write soon, and our starting symbol is S. And let's say these are my set of production rules. We have S gives AAS BB, or S gives epsilon. So, I'll just move, since the production rules are most important to us, which describe the entire grammar, I just take it on the next slide. Now, given to us a string, let's say AA. How do we check this string and see that it is generated by this grammar? We have seen this, that we can done it with the help of a parse tree or a derivation tree. Let's quickly recap that. So, what we will do is, we know that this S here, it's going to generate either this particular string or it give me an epsilon. Since we see that epsilon is, this string is not epsilon, the string which we are trying to generate is not epsilon, we can reject this branch. Now, moving on with this branch, do we know whether this branch can be a potential branch or it should also be rejected? So, for checking that, we can see that this AA is also generated. So, these two A's are generated by this particular branch of derivation tree. This remaining string might be generated by this, the remaining portion of this string. SBB might generate this AA followed by 4 times B. So, this is a potential branch. So, again, we go further. Again, we can apply any one of the two rules. So, we apply first rule. First rule gives us this. And the second rule gives us this. Again, we see that this particular branch will be rejected. Why? Because here after 2As, we have 2As more. Here after 2As, we start with B. So this one is rejected. What about this one? So these 4As match the 4As of my input string, right? And after that, I have an S. So still it is a potential branch. Again, I can go one step further. So I might getting up this. Or if I put an epsilon instead of S, we get end up getting this. So here if we see this particular branch, this is accepted because we have 4 times A followed by 4 times B. What about this branch? So after 4As, we have 2 Bs here. But in this case, after 4As, we are again having 2 As. So this branch is rejected. Let us take one more example. Assume there were only 3 A's here followed by 4 B's. So in that case, how it will work? So till here, the things remain as it is. So in that case, this branch was rejected. Now this particular branch, we can either have it in this way or we can have AABB. Now if we look at this branch, after 2As we have a third A, but here after 2As we have a B, so this is rejected. If we look in this case, after 3As we have a B, but here after 3As we have another A. So this branch in no way can yield me 3As followed by 4B. So this is also rejected, and this shows that your string is not generated by the grammar. We can use exactly the same procedure which we just now did using this whiteboard. We can use this same procedure for creating a pushdown automata for this. Let's talk about this particular example itself. Later we'll see how to generalize this. This was my language, and now I am trying to create a pushdown automata for this. So going by the same principle which we just now used, what we can do is, I'm going to create a pushdown automata here. This is my initial state. We can also make it a final state, but let's not do that as of now. So what we will do is, as we know, how do we know that a stack is empty? So to denote that a stack is empty, we always push a special symbol dollar in the stack. So what we are going to do here is, without seeing anything on the input tape and without seeing anything in the stack, initially we just push a dollar in the stack. So this is Q1, this is Q2. What next? What next we'll do is, we'll also insert this initial symbol S. So let me do it along with the derivation so that we understand what is happening. Since we'll be starting our derivation with S, so initially we'll just push this S into our stack as well. So to push the S in stack, I can give another transition here without looking at the input tape and without looking at anything in the stack, also push the initial symbol S in the stack. So in our derivation tree, as of now, we are having a S here. Next, what we have to do, we can replace S by either this production rule or this production rule. So the non-determinism of PDA helps us doing this thing. What I can do now, I can pop this S from this stack and store this particular branch of the production in S or this particular branch. So what do I do for that? We put a production rule here. Sorry, we put a transition here. So what does the transition say? Without seeing anything on the input tape, if your stack top is the starting symbol S, then I am going to replace it with this entire string AASBB, or what I can do, I can also replace it with epsilon. So what my PDA will do, it will go in both of these directions. So what it will do is, if this is the current state of my stack, it can go in one of the two states. So what will be the first one doing? First one will pop S and insert a AAS BB at this place. So while inserting, you read it from the rightmost side. So you first push a B, then a B, then a S, then an A, and then an A. In the second case, you push an epsilon, which means that you just end up popping S from this. So these are the two possible configurations of stack. So this is allowed only because of non-determinism. Okay, what next? So I'm also assuming that my input tape consists of this string here, let's say A, and let's say then 4 times B, which should be actually accepted, right? Okay. What next I'll do? We always know that we also have this transition always, that whenever your input is anything, but if you see a dollar symbol on your stack, then you actually pop that dollar symbol and go to the final state, right? So you should see that. So assume that I'm processing this particular string. So initially we inserted this dollar. Next, what we did, since it's a non-deterministic machine, I can take this transition or this one. Assume that I take this second transition from Q3. So from Q3 now, since my stack top contains dollar, I can take this particular transition and come to the final state. But you should see the string will be rejected. Why? Because when I come to Q4, I haven't, my input head is still here on this A. Right, so I am yet to read my string, but I came to the final state, so it will be outright rejected. Okay, next what? So if I take, what I mean to say is not this entire string is rejected. If at this point in time, if you take this particular transition here and comes to Q4, so this branch will reject your string, but my another branch, this branch is still active. So which basically means that this branch is rejected. So also in a derivation tree, we saw that S can either give us a AASBB or it can give us an epsilon. So this particular branch was rejected. Okay, next what? So this was when we see an S here. Next, how are we working in the case of our derivation tree, since there are two A's here and there are two A's in the input string. So still I am up. So this particular branch of the derivation tree can yield me the desired string. So what I am going to do is, in case I see an A on the input string and also an A on the stack, I am just going to pop that A. Similarly, if I see a B on the input string and B on the stack, I am just going to pop that B. So what will happen now? At this particular step, we have seen that if we take this particular transition, it's a dead end, right? Now what? If you see, there is an A on my input tape and there is also an A on the stack top. So what we can do is push pop this A and just go one step further here. After coming one step further here, what do we see? Again, there is an A on the input tape and there is an A on the stack. So see, there is an A on the stack. So we can pop this A and my input head comes here. Now, my input head is containing an A, but my stack is containing the starting symbol S, right? So again, by virtue of these two production rules, my stack can go to one of these states. So what can be one of these states? So you can replace S by either this or this. In case we replace S by the first one, so you should see my input stack becomes, so you have a dollar and then a B and then a B. So we pop this S and instead of this, So we pop this S and instead of this we push a B, B and then an S and then A and then A here, right? So this is one possible configuration of the stack. And what is the another possible configuration of the stack? If we push epsilon instead of S there, it becomes dollar and then B and then B and then epsilon, which means that S is also popped, right? Let me just take it to the next page. Okay, let me cut it. So these are the two possible configurations of the stack now. Now where will this particular configuration go? So if I apply these rules, so what is the state of my input tape as of now? So I was having AAAA, BBBB, and our head was there on the third A, right? Okay, now which all transitions can we apply? We cannot apply this transition here because I do not see a dollar in the on the stack top. Then we cannot apply this transition because for applying this transition your stack top as well as the input alphabet should be B, right? We can only apply this particular transition here, right? So since there is no transition at Q3 where your input symbol is A and your stack top is B, this branch is rejected. Again, you should see how that holds in the derivation tree. So our derivation tree was this. Again, it can yield us two things. So one thing is AAAAS, BBBB, and other was if I apply a epsilon here. So you should see that this particular configuration corresponds to this part of your derivation tree which was rejected. And here this particular configuration is rejected. What next? So I am at this state now. So what I am going to do, I see an A on the input tape as well as on stack. I pop it, move further, and again I pop it and move further. So my input now stands at the first B and my stack top contains S. Again, this particular configuration will yield us two configurations. So I'm starting from this one here. It can yield us two configurations. So the first one is we can pop S and replace it by this string, and second is we can replace it with an epsilon. So if we replace S by this particular string, what does it become? This will be my new configuration. And if we replace S by epsilon, then this is going to be the new configuration. So the S is simply popped there. Okay. What I can do next, so these are my current, so if this is my current stack configuration, I see an A on the stack top, but on the input tape I am seeing an B. So this particular configuration is rejected. So you should see that this particular configuration will correspond to the derivation branch when we will further replace this S with AASBB. Right, so this one was rejected, and the other case will be when you put an epsilon here, in that case it becomes A4S B4. So if you put an epsilon there, this is your current branch. So here what you can see, there is a B in the stack, B in the input tape, you pop it, move further. Again B in the stack, B in the input tape, pop it, move further, and you pop it, right? And now you get what? A dollar at the stack. Your input tape is complete, you have read all the input, and your stack top is what? Dollar. So you can now take this transition and come to Q4, which is your final state, and hence this is, this particular input is accepted, this particular string is accepted. We can actually generalize this for any given grammar. In this example, we have taken a particular grammar, but if we wanted to generalize it for any grammar, we can do that. So these steps are exactly the same. What are we going to do is, so the very first step was, we have pushed this string $s on the stack. So this is in general for any grammar. So in the initially, you just put a dollar and a s on the stack. Second, if you see a variable on the stack top, so in the case, I am going to write it like this, if stack top is a variable, so if it belongs to v, v was variable, what we will do, we will just pop this stack top and we will replace it by corresponding production rules. So there can be more than one production rule, which shows that there can be more than one possible transition, which is again allowed because our machine is non-deterministic. Else means your stack top is not variable, it's a terminal. So else what you can do, if your stack top, whatever that is, which is a terminal, is equal to the same symbol which is there at your read tape. Read tape's head is the same symbol which is at your head of read tape. What do you do? You pop stack top from the stack and you move read head one step further, right? So this was your second step. And the third step remains same. What is that? When you see, so this is for every step. So this is the first step. Second step, you keep repeating it. While doing the second step, if there ever comes a point when you see a dollar at your stack top and your input reading is complete, your input head is at the end of your read tape, you accept. So in case we want to write it down formally, we can do that. So there is one more thing here. So if you look at this state Q3 here, right? So at the state Q3, what we are doing is we are replacing this S by this complete string AASBB here. So till now, whatever PDAs we have made, we have always pushed or popped only one symbol at a time. So here is a case where we are writing a string in the stack. How is that possible? Because our PDA only allows us pushing one symbol at a time. So you can actually break down this step and write it as multiple steps. How you can do that is, so how we can do that is at Q3, right? epsilon s gives us epsilon. There is no issue in that. So when this entire string has to be written, what we can do is on epsilon s, what we can do is first write an a here. I write a a here and go to another state q4, let's say q5, because q4 is already there. On q5, without seeing anything, I can just push another a. Then again, I can just push this s there. We can just keep pushing all these symbols here. So what I am doing is I am just unfolding this transition for this state q3. So what we have done is when we were pushing this entire string into the stack, so if we want to write it in such a form where only one symbol is pushed to the stack at a time, we can unfold it like this. So what it will do at q3, whenever it sees a s, what it can do, it can either pop that s, or what it can do, it can come here, write an a and go to the state q5. Now from the state q5, you can keep moving without seeing any symbol on the stack and without seeing anything on the input tape. You can write a s b b and then come back to the same state q3. So in general, if I have something like this in my PDA, let's say a string here, a long string here. In general, if I have a this particular thing and this thing are equivalent, so I can also write it as so both of these transitions are actually equivalent. So I can come to QJ directly on by pushing this on the stack, or I can push this on the stack. There is a slight mistake I have done here. So what is the mistake here? So you should see that when I am pushing it on this stack,